Good evening, everyone. At the outset, I would like to thank AIC and LOC for giving us the opportunity to speak. Today, I'll be speaking on post-penetrating keratoplastic glaucoma, general principles of medical and surgical management. Again, no financial interest. By definition, post-penetrating keratoplastic glaucoma, it refers to an elevated intraocular pressure greater than 21 millimeters of mercury after penetrating keratoplasty with or without associated visual field loss or optic nerve edge changes. Again, it's the second leading cause of graft failure next to graft rejection. Irwin and Kaufman were the first to note post-penetrating keratoplastic glaucoma. Again, the prevalence and incidence differs in different studies. In early post-operative period, the incidence rate is around 9 to 31%, and in late post-operative period, it's around 18 to 35%. The risk factors which leads to increase in intraocular pressure and the factors for which we do keratoplasty are aphakic and pseudophakic bullous keratopathy, ICE syndrome, pre-existing glaucoma, perforated corneal ulcer, aderant leukoma, previous keratoplasty done, post-traumatic cases, combined keratoplasty with cataract extraction, vitrectomy done during penetrating keratoplasty. These are all factors that lead to increase in intraocular pressure. Some factors like keratoconus and congenital hereditary endothelial dystrophy leads to lower risk of increase in IOP. Again, post-penetrating keratoplastic glaucoma, it's a diagnostic difficulty because due to primary corneal disease, we are not able to accurately measure the intraocular pressure as well as note down the IOP, optic nerve changes as well as the visual field changes. So again, it's a diagnostic difficulty. Post-penetrating keratoplastic glaucoma, again, the intraocular pressure measurement is the sole important factor that that can detect the post-PK glaucoma. In case of irregular corneal surface, newer tonometers like MAC-GMR tonometer, pneumatic tonometer, tonopen, and dynamic contour tonometer, these are some of the tonometers which can be used to measure the pressures in irregular corneal surface. Ultrasound biomicroscopy, it's useful in eyes where to note down the anterior segment details which are unclear due to failed graft. It can be used to assess angles to establish the cause of glaucoma, and it's useful tool for planning the site for glaucoma filtering surgeries. Again, few of the features of UBM, as we can see, pass can be seen over here. Graft host junction synechiae can be seen. IOL iris synechiae can be seen, and central iridocorneal synechiae as depicted by Dada et al. In Cornea 2008 study. ASOCT, it's similar to ultrasound in which it allows the visualization through the opaque media, the advantage being its non-contact and non-immersion method. Management of post-penetrating keratoplastic glaucoma, as it can be done by preventive as well as treatment part. Preoperatively, what we can do is like pre-existing glaucoma has to be detected. Pre-existing glaucoma is a major risk factor for post-PK glaucoma. It was been estimated that the 3-year graft survival rate is around 71% in patients with pre-existing glaucoma as compared to 89% in with no history of glaucoma. So there is increased incidence of graft failure with glaucoma surgery after PKB. Some studies, depicted combining trabeculectomy or glaucoma drainage device with keratoplasty. Again, some of the surgical variables that can be done to reduce angle compression, like lesser tight sutures during keratoplasty, deep sutures, short sutures, equidistant sutures from on either side of the wound, smaller size graft, the larger donor size graft at least larger than 0.5 to 1 millimeter, and thinner recipient cornea. These are some intraoperative factors. Others being floppy iris can be sutured by direct suturing, or iridoplasty can be done to prevent future pus formation. Thorough viscoelastic removal can be done. Careful wound closure has to be done. Peripheral eritectomy, it's a routine process that has to be done. Tight flap sutures and well-formed anterior chamber is some things. Post-operatively, we have to prevent inflammation as well as pus formation by judicious use of topical steroids. Cycloplegics has to be started to keep the pupil mobile and prevent any pupillary block glaucoma. Monitoring of IOP is an important factor to prevent steroid-induced secondary glaucomas. Topical anti-glaucoma medication, these are first-line therapy. Long-term usage, the preservative has a toxic effect on the corneal epithelium by cell wall damage. So generally, the preservative-free formulations and unims has to be encouraged. Peculiar side effects of the drugs has to be kept in mind, and depending on that, we have to choose the drugs from the list of the drugs what we have. These are some of the commonly used drugs. Newer drugs like latanoprostol or netrasertib, these have got FDA approval, but then not yet available in the market. Few of the glaucoma medications with their local side effects. Beta blockers and alpha agonists, they have a similar basket of local side effects like superficial punctate keratitis, corneal anesthesia, and dry eye due to decrease in aqueous layer of the tear, as well as the quantity and quality of mucoid layer. Topical carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, they inhibit the carbonic anhydrase enzyme. So in case of borderline graft, borderline endothelium, they can lead to graft failure. PG analogs can cause uveitis. They can cause CME, and they can, the herpes simplex infection can be recurred. So again, that is detrimental to graft health. Miotics can cause inflammation and retinal detachment. And adrenergic agents, they can cause epithelial toxicity and CME. So in a long term, we have to think of all these local side effects and titrate the drugs according to this. Systemic carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, they are like very useful to prevent, very useful in preventing spikes in early post-operative period, but then long-term therapy, the systemic side effects has to be think of, and they are detrimental to the systemic health. Lasers in glaucoma, argon laser trabeculoplasty and selective laser trabeculoplasty can be tried in open angles with clear grafts and moderately elevated intraocular pressure. Again, the results, the IOP lowering effect of these lasers are variable and they decrease over time. So again, the post-operative IOP spikes and uveitis, they can trigger graft rejection. So they have to be cautious while using them. Pupillary block, whenever suspected, can be dealt with NDAC laser iridotomy whenever the graft clarity is there. Gonioplasty can be done when the pass is less than a year. Conventional trabeculectomy, again, there's a risk of failure, which is secondary to limbal conjunctival scarring from previous surgery, extensive peripheral synechiae, aphakia, and extremely shallow anterior chambers. So trabeculectomy, along with the antimetabolites like mitomycin C and 5-FU, antimetabolites, they have an antifibrotic property, and they leads to bleb formation. So mitomycin C in the dose of 0.2 to 0.4 milligram, 1 to 4 minutes subconjunctivally or subsclerally can be used with a single application. No demonstrable toxicity in the corneal epithelium, and we have to be guarded for thin cystic bleb formation and bleb-related infections. Again, the indications of trabeculectomy with antimetabolites being post-PK glaucoma, which is medically uncontrolled with no or limited conjunctival scarring, absence of peripheral synechiae, and extremely shallow anterior chamber. The success rate of trabeculectomy with antimetabolites was IOP control being 67 to 91% and graft failure rate between 12 to 18%. Glaucoma drainage devices can be used, as they can create a alternate aqueous pathway by channeling aqueous from the AC through a long tube to the equatorial plate and promoting bleb formation. Valved like Ahmad glaucoma valve can be used, valveless like Bavels and RD implant can also be used. Their indications being those glaucoma which are refractory to medical treatment, failed trabeculectomy, extensive limbal scarring prior from prior surgery, and extensive peripheral synechiae. Again, the IOP control with GDDs is a good number, 71 to 96% IOP control is there, but the graft failure rate is around 10 to 51%. That is a little risky. Risk of graft rejection involved as well as valveless is as per studies, is equal. most of the corneal transplant undergoes 60% reduction in the endothelial count in first two post-op years after the implant surgery. The tubes, they act as a conduit for inflammatory cells to pass from the equatorial plate to the AC form, AC. So they can incite uveitis or pus formation. There is a breakdown of blood aqueous barrier as well as the multiple previous surgeries. These all can trigger the graft rejection in and graft failure in case of GDDs. Again, the timing of GDD is important. Some studies suggest GDD planned after keratoplasty has a good graft health rate. So again, the glaucoma drainage device related, surgery related complications like tube endothelial touch or tube obstruction and tube plate extrusion, these all can lead to graft failure in patients with glaucoma. Again, the comparative study of Ahmad glaucoma wall, which was limbal in post-penetrating keratoplastic glaucoma, by Indian perspective, was done in 2010 by Panda et al., where the 20 eyes were studied, and absolute success was found in 55% of the cases, and qualified success was around 30 with medications and 15 with minor surgery. TRAB versus TRAB with antimetabolites versus glaucoma drainage device in post-PK glaucoma was studied by Yakin et al., where the cumulative probability of IOP success at the end of 3 years was around 84%, as compared to 64% in TRAB with antimetabolites. But the cumulative probability of corneal graft survival rate was high with trabeculectomy with antimetabolites at the end of the 3 years, being 67%, and 52.6% by glaucoma drainage device at the end of the 3 years. So it was been concluded that glaucoma drainage devices are more successful in controlling IOP, but they tend to have a low graft survival rates. Pars plana tube insertion of glaucoma drainage implants post-PK glaucoma was studied by Paul et al. The IOP control and graft clarity the results were quite reasonably good. Ab external cyclodialysis enhanced TRAB was studied by Sihota et al. In 2010, where 45 patients had good IOP control and no incidence of graft failure following surgery. Cyclodestructive surgeries can be tried when filtration surgery and glaucoma drainage devices have high failure rate. Again, as they destroy the part of ciliary body, chances of thysis bulbi are more. So newer lasers like Cyclo G6 can be used with micropulse 8-10 nanometer infrared lasers, which are less destructive, which can cause minimal inflammation and good IOP control, and these are repeatable. So this can be used in high failure rate cases. Express mini shunt was studied by Halil et al. In 2010. In 15 patients, he concluded that the grafts remained clear after the surgery. The edematous graft became clear due to a decrease in IOP. The IOP control was quite reasonably good. So the pulse of this surgery was, the IOP control was good, with acceptable graft failure rate. Again, it's a safe alternative to trabeculectomy, as we can put the express implant below the scleral flap. No need of doing a PSO, chances of inflammation are less. Safer alternative to glaucoma drainage device, as the tube-related endothelial complications are less, limitation being the cost factor and limited study results. So to conclude, I would say that management of post-PKP glaucoma remains a clinical challenge. Careful evaluation of pre-existing glaucoma prior to corneal transplant is important. Again, it's important to initial treatment of elevated IOP in both early and late post-operative period is medical therapy. Proper surgical timing is must. Meticulous surgical maneuvers that can minimize the risk of disturbing the anterior chamber angle and causing pupillary block has to be done. Surgical intervention of poorly controlled glaucoma when the medical therapy has failed. IOP monitoring is important, especially in response to cortical steroids, as they have to be put on long-term basis. Optimal surveillance and aggressive medical and surgical management can salvage both graft and vision in these already compromised eyes. Thank you.